for a nuclear weapon, was working on several different methods of enriching uranium, and recently was discovered seeking significant quantities of uranium from Africa. The regime plays host to terrorists, including Al-Qaeda, as the president indicated. Saddam's regime hides military equipment in or near mosques, hospitals, civilian homes, and has a history of using innocent civilians as human shields. That is why, as he said, our nation and the world must not allow a brutal dictator with a history of reckless aggression and ties to terrorism to dominate a vital region and threaten the United States. For those who counsel more time for inspections, the president responded that we have given Saddam Hussein more than a decade to give up chemical, biological, and his nuclear weapon program. Yet nothing to date has restrained him. Not economic sanctions, not diplomacy, not isolation from the civilized world, not even cruise missile strikes on his military facilities. He's now refusing to cooperate with the 17th UN Security Council resolution. As Mr. Blix's report pointed out, at what point do reasonable people conclude that we know his answer as to whether or not he intends to cooperate and voluntarily disarm? As the president made clear, the dictator of Iraq is not disarming. To the contrary, he is deceiving. His time to do so is running out. It's up to Iraq to prevent the use of force, and let's hope that they do so. General Myers.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary, and good afternoon. First, operations continue in Afghanistan. On Monday, a U.S. Special Forces unit was engaged by enemy forces near Spin Boldock and returned fire. Then they detained an individual following that exchange of force with close air support, moved into the area.
About the information that Secretary Powell provided to the Security Council next week, I believe it's February 5th. People in this building, including you, have said that you have proof that Iraq is still cheating the inspectors and even the most recent inspections. Will the information that you provide, including perhaps satellite photographs, will it be more directed to show that the Iraqis are still cheating the inspectors, or will it provide direct information of weapons that the Iraqis still have these weapons? Could you give us some information on the intelligence?
Well, the president outlined a good portion of the case yesterday evening. The agency, Central Intelligence Agency, is in the process of developing the final materials that will be used by Secretary Powell. I do not, and they're in the process of declassifying certain things, and I do not know what that final draft will look like. I've seen earlier iterations, but there certainly will be information that will be provided as they go through that declassification process. I think the way to think about it is this. There's two, but there's one threshold issue, and that's the issue of preemption. And it is difficult for all of us who've grown up in this country and believed in the principle that unless attacked, one does not attack. And other countries have had different approaches, but for the most part, our country has had a view that was the way we did things. It was other countries that have attacked us for the most part and initiated conflicts. The question, though, is in the 21st century, with biological weapons, for example, that could kill hundreds of thousands of people, what does one do? Does one wait until they're attacked, or does one look at a pattern of behavior and a fact pattern and draw a conclusion? And so that key threshold issue is one that our country and the people of our country and the world have engaged, and because it's new and because it's difficult and not easy, and we've had September 11th and some 3,000 human beings, innocent men, women, and children of all nationalities and religions lost their lives. A biological attack that killed 300,000 or more would affect people's judgment about whether or not they would prefer that their government act before the fact. And there is no doubt in my mind but that the overwhelming majority of the American people would prefer that their government take the kinds of steps necessary to prevent that type of attack. So that's the first issue. The second issue is people are kind of looking for a photograph or a thing that they can hold up and say, aha, that proves something. As I've said here, the Congress spent months trying to connect the dots after September 11th, trying to figure out what happened. How did all of those things go along, and how could we not know it and stop it? And wouldn't we have acted preemptively to stop it had we been able to figure out how to stop it? It's hard to connect the dots even after the fact these many months, with going over thousands of documents up there in the Hill. Now they've appointed another commission to look at it. It's even harder to connect the dots before something happens. But if you think of this fact pattern, you have a country that had chemical and biological weapons and an active nuclear program, according to the UN inspectors who were in that were found. You have a country that was asked by the United Nations in the 17th resolution to declare what they have after lengthy diplomacy, lengthy economic sanctions, to declare what they have, bring it forward so that they can be disarmed. You have a country that agreed to do that. And then you have a country that declined to do it by filing a declaration that was fraudulent, by taking steps to inhibit the inspectors from doing their work in a reasonable way, by behaving totally differently than South Africa or Ukraine or Kazakhstan, which invited inspectors in, showed the world what they had, had them dismantled and disarmed. Totally opposite. They're telling their people to lie to the inspectors. They're telling their people to hide things. They're taking documentation and putting it in multiple locations. You have a country that is out in the world buying things that are necessary for the development and progress in their chemical, biological, and nuclear programs. And they're doing it not openly and saying it's dual-use material and we're doing it innocently, but clandestinely, and paying more money than they need to. So if you walk your way down there, and then you say to yourself, this is a country that's not a normal country. This is not Canada or Australia or some country that behaves as a good citizen of the world. This is a country that has used chemical weapons against its own people, that's used chemical weapons against its neighbor, that's fired ballistic missiles into four countries in the region, that's threatened the United States of America, that has relationships with terrorist networks. Now, what is all that can force a person to think? It seems to me that at some point one has to say, what ought a person to think about all of that? And that to me is evidence as hard as a photograph. Indeed, it is critically important.
Donald Rumsfeld there, the Defense Secretary, doing his level best to explain
and come to their
the
own conclusion
current
about
dilemma
about
that America and the other nations within the United Nations Security Council have about whether or not to go to war against Iraq, and really perhaps underlining how difficult it is. As he says, it's a question of whether...
The day that subject came up was 15-4. And the questions came out of the press corps, well, Europe's against you. Well, Europe's not against us. The vote was 15 in favor of our position, 14 other countries and ours in favor of our position, and there were four countries that were on the other side. And it seems to me that simply because one or two countries are against, it's a mistake to think that that means all of Europe, because there are any number of countries that have been very helpful and are participating in planning, both planning in the event force has to be used and planning in the event that there is a post-Saddam Hussein Iraq in terms of humanitarian assistance and reconstruction.
Mr. Secretary?
Yes.
Mr. Secretary, on Monday, Iraqi Deputy Prime Minister Tariq Aziz said that if attacked by the United States, since Iraq could not counterattack against the United States directly, that Iraq might launch some sort of attempt at striking Kuwait and other Gulf states that are helping the United States. Mm-hmm. Two questions about that. First off, what is
they've done that before? that wouldn't be their first time attacking their neighbors.
What is the administration's response to that threat, and is the United States prepared to and capable, of course, of defending Kuwait and the other Gulf states that are helping us with this?
There's no question but that there are a whole series of things that can happen, and that they have been examined by General Tom Franks and his associates, and by the chiefs and the chairman and the vice chairman here, and that those possibilities have been considered and addressed.
You consider it a serious threat, obviously.
I consider any threat serious.
Mr. Secretary, I have a question for General Myers, but before that, I'd like to defer to a visiting correspondent who's bona fide, who has a question for you, and I will ask General Myers my question, if I may.
I get the feeling he's taking over the press briefing. Yeah.
Well, you always ask me to ask General Myers a question.
Sure. That's good. Yes. Hello.
Thank you.
Mr. Secretary. Okay, we've been listening there with the U.S. Secretary of Defense, Donald Rumsfeld, taking questions there from reporters about the possible war, about the proof that the United States will be able to produce, especially when the U.S. Secretary of State addresses the U.N. Security Council next week, February 5th. Basically, the Secretary of Defense said that the proof which he has...
Il compenso e nessuno saprà niente.
Va bene, avanti. Adesso dimmi il tuo piano.
E poi, fra un paio di settimane, nessuno si ricorderà di una stupida festa di anniversario.
Attenzione, per favore! Ho aspettato 50 anni per dire questa cosa.
Aspetta, papà. Dillo alla telecamera e conserveremo questo momento per sempre. Ehi, ragazzi, venite qua un attimo!
Ok, arriviamo. Coraggio, andiamo a immortalare questo momento sul videotape.
Io non so perché ci abbia messo tanto tempo a dirla voi, figli miei, ma io vi adoro, vi adoro tutti!
Brava Pia, non si ferma richiesta. Torniamo ad Anza.
His regime has the design for a nuclear weapon, was working on several different methods of enriching uranium, and recently was discovered seeking significant quantities of uranium from Africa. The regime plays host to terrorists, including Al-Qaeda, as the president indicated. Saddam's regime hides military equipment in or near mosques, hospitals, civilian homes, and has a history of using innocent civilians as human shields. That is why, as he said, our nation and the world must not allow a brutal dictator with a history of reckless aggression and ties to terrorism to dominate a vital region and threaten the United States. For those who counsel more time for inspections, the president responded that we have given Saddam Hussein more than a decade to give up chemical, biological, and his nuclear weapon program. Yet nothing to date has restrained him. Not economic sanctions, not diplomacy, not isolation from the civilized world, not even cruise missile strikes on his military facilities. He's now refusing to cooperate with the 17th UN Security Council resolution. As Mr. Blix's report pointed out, at what point do reasonable people conclude that we know his answer as to whether or not he intends to cooperate and voluntarily disarm? As the president made clear, the dictator of Iraq is not disarming. To the contrary, he is deceiving. His time to do so is running out. It's up to Iraq to prevent the use of force. And let's hope that they do so. General Myers.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary, and good afternoon. First operations continue in Afghanistan. On Monday, a U.S. Special Forces unit was engaged by enemy forces near Spin Boldock and returned fire. Then they detained an individual following that exchange of force with close air support, moved into the area.
About the information that Secretary Powell provided to the Security Council next week, I believe it's February 5th. People in this building, including you, have said that you have proof that Iraq is still cheating the inspectors and even the most recent inspections. Will the information that you provide, including perhaps satellite photographs, will it be more directed to show that the Iraqis are still cheating the inspectors, all will provide direct information of weapons that the Iraqis still have these weapons. Could you give us some information on the intelligence?
Well, the president outlined a good portion of the case yesterday evening. The agency, Central Intelligence Agency, is in the process of developing the final materials that will be used by Secretary Powell. I do not, and they're in the process of declassifying certain things, and I do not know what that final draft will look like. I've seen earlier iterations, but there certainly will be information that will be provided as they go through that declassification process. I think the way to think about it is this. There's two, but there's one threshold issue, and that's the issue of preemption. And it is difficult for all of us who've grown up in this country and believed in the principle that unless attacked, one does not attack. And other countries have had different approaches, but for the most part, our country has had a view that was the way we did things. It was other countries that have attacked us for the most part and initiated conflicts. The question, though, is in the 21st century, with biological weapons, for example, that could kill hundreds of thousands of people, what does one do? Does one wait until they're attacked, or does one look at a pattern of behavior and a pattern of a fact pattern and draw a conclusion? And so that key threshold issue is one that our country and the people of our country and the world have engaged, and because it's new and because it's difficult and not easy, and we've had September 11th and some 3,000 human beings, innocent men, women, and children of all nationalities and religions lost their lives. A biological attack that killed 300,000 or more would affect people's judgment about whether or not they would prefer that their government act before the fact. And there is no doubt in my mind but that the overwhelming majority of the American people would prefer that their government take the kinds of steps necessary to prevent that type of attack. So that's the first issue. The second issue is people are kind of looking for a photograph or a thing that they can hold up and say, aha, that proves something. As I've said here, the Congress spent months trying to connect the dots after September 11th, trying to figure out what happened. How did all of those things go along, and how could we not know it and stop it? And wouldn't we have acted preemptively to stop it had we been able to figure out how to stop it? It's hard to connect the dots even after the fact these many months, with going over thousands of documents up there in the Hill. Now they've appointed another commission to look at it. It's even harder to connect the dots before something happens. But if you think of this fact pattern, you have a country that had chemical and biological weapons and an active nuclear program, according to the UN inspectors who were in that were found. You have a country that was asked by the United Nations in the 17th resolution to declare what they have after lengthy diplomacy, lengthy economic sanctions, to declare what they have, bring it forward so that they can be